Sai is a true radiologist.
Yeah, he is a good radiologist to read X-rays. And I know the present young radiologists, they don't read the X-rays properly. Am I correct? They are well versed with MRI, CT, and all.
Evening, sir. Thank you so much for the introduction. Thank you so much for calling me here to make a presentation on two of my existing cases also. It gives me great privilege to stand in front of all my teachers and colleagues here to make this presentation. So I started off with this X-ray. So this is the history sir was talking about. This is an 80-year-old gentleman who had difficulty in swallowing. He was having upper abdominal discomfort and heartburns. He was regurgitating food particles. He was having cough, he was feeling breathless, he was being dyspneic, and he was having nausea and vomiting as well. So all this happened in the last 5 months, and the symptoms are progressive. He was a diabetic and hypertensive. He'd been on regular follow-up medication. General physical examination, he had a soft abdomen, no tenderness. His chest showed a lot of signs. He had bilateral wheeze. He had some crepitations in the base. There was reduced iron free as well. So this was the X-ray that we were discussing about. We were all feeling little. We also wanted a CT as suggested. So we got a CT done. I'll anyway show the CT pictures. But since this patient came with a primary symptom of vomiting, nausea, loss of weight, and an elderly male, we were considering a malignancy as the first diagnosis. So we thought we should put an endoscopy for it. So we did an endoscopy for them, and endoscopy showed puckered lower esophageal junction. There was severe esophageal candidiasis. It was very difficult to negotiate the scope beyond the OG. Although we did, but it was not clear at all. There was a lot of food particle, and so we abandoned the procedure from there on. So this was the endoscopic finding, and then we took the CT. So the CT, now there was a shift in the concentration. It now comes out of the esophagus. It was a very dilated esophagus in the middle and the distal third, and a very taper, narrow distal esophagus. And we also saw that this was the finding for the X-ray. There was patchy defined granular opacity on both the lower lobes, just to aspiration pneumonitis. So now it was quite clear that it was an esophageal achalasia cardia, which was causing stasis in the esophagus with aspiration because it was an elderly. Not a very classic finding that you would see in an elderly, 8-decade-old patient. So considering his age and his scarred lungs and a lot of morbidities that he's got, not a very great lifespan with open surgery, with large extremity, so we thought we could do a balloon dilatation for him. We went on and dilated his ischia with a 30mm balloon, 8 centimeters, for about sustained dilatation of about 60 seconds. We repeated this procedure 2 times the same sitting. There was a bit of a waste during the first time, but this was done under anesthesia, so we did not have pain. So post-procedure, we monitored him. This was a post-dilatation picture on the OG. So post-procedure, it was, as expected, he didn't have much complications though. There wasn't retrosternal pain or fever, so we were thinking about some kind of perforation during the procedure. Then he was initiated on solids, semi-solids. He was in hospital for about 2 days. And he was discharged with medications. So before I go to the second case, is there something we can discuss about this?
Can you put the lung window?
Yeah.
CT. This is mid estimate.
Yeah. It's
because this one opacity which is coming here in that what we have seen it in chest X-ray. This one we have perceived in the lung. This is in a mid estimate window. Where you can esophagus is dilated and then showing that lesion here.
Yeah.
But this one you have to see it in the lung window. You can see what is that vertical one. It's aspiration. Pneumonitis means you see a multiple small rounded lesions here in that venous.
We didn't talk to the radiologist from the scan center. They said it is more of aspiration pneumonitis.
So the linear shadow, you told me that there was due to the pneumonitis.
That's what the discussion radiologist also said.
Because it is a linear sort of clear cut margin where you get a pneumonitis. You don't have a clear cut margin, you have bizarre features.
The CT feature. The CT feature. whole thing is the esophagus.
Yeah.
Within that esophagus, it's a dilated, and then you can see there is a lesion is inside that CA esophagus. What would have caused here is that dilated esophagus would have compressed this bronchus, and you are seeing as a vertical shadow where the whatever the secretions is there, it is not draining it out. But we have to see it in the lung window, that will show you whether this, see here also that linear opacity is coming. It is grossly distended, compressing the lower lobe bronchus. That is causing that from that. We have to see it.
So it's a bronchial dilatation, sir?
Yes.
So bronchial dilatation, the secretion that showed a linear.
Yes,
yes. I don't think it's a pneumonitis.
Pneumonitis is a picture. So pneumonitis. Some pneumonitis is there. Main problem was that smooth band like shadow. So you say it is left main bronchus?
No, whatever the you cannot see it now.
Yeah.
I see it in the lung window where the bronchus, the gross dilatation of the esophagus would have compressed the adjacent bronchus. That whatever secretion is there that is retained in that, that is appearing like a vertical shadow.
Actually, the differential diagnosis of difficult asthma is a gastroesophageal reflux disease with the aspiration of various substances in duodenum. That's exactly happens. That's what he said, the back of the mind keep the aspiration. That happens depends on the food. For example, night he takes every night. And whatever chemical is in the food that goes to the lungs. And these people, fortunately, because they got a healthy lung, they don't go to the violent reactions of fibrosis or collapse or obstruction, consolidation, loss of blood volume. They only manifest with the linear shadows. And subsequent consequence of linear shadows, some very shadow demonic consolidation. That's what the picture is. Linear shadows of aspiration with a very consolidation. This common picture in GRB disease. That's why you ask them to take slower, you need to go into bed and have the head elevated cardiac position. Almost we advise a cardiac cord for this patient.
Thank you so much, sir. I have a second case to present. This is more of my comfort zone. So this is a 37-year-old lady who presented to me with again severe vomiting, dysphagia, and chest bloating. It was initially more to solids and it's been progressing in the last 1.5 years. She's lost 40 kilos in the last 18 months, which is quite significant. She's been treated all over India and she's been on anxiolytics, a lot of other medications for esophagitis, but nothing really worked for her. So this is her entire past medical evaluation. She's had endoscopy done 12 times and in each center she's been given different diagnoses, GERD, reflux esophagitis, pangastritis. So based on all of this, she was suggested medical management and at some centers even surgery for reflux disease. Since she wasn't very happy with the medical management, she did not opt for surgery at that point in time. She was known hypothyroid and also has sleep disorder, which the family has been saying that it's probably because of her unresolved medical condition. There aren't any other medical illnesses. She has 2 children, normal vaginal delivery, and she's had a very normal gestation period. Now she has regular cycles also. So clinical evaluation, nothing much actually. She looked pale. There was not much of dehydration for the amount of vomiting that she presented with. She's lost a lot of weight, so there's a lot of subcutaneous fat loss with a lot of skin sagging. Her heart rate was all right. She was normal tensor, didn't have a goiter to her abdomen, except that she had very mild upper abdominal tenderness. It was all right. There was nothing else physically that I could find out from her. So this is what at the end of the history physical examination that we have. There's a young lady with severe vomiting, no dehydration, some amount of upper abdomen pain and chest bloat. That's it that she has, she's questioned a bit. So we're probably looking at an esophageal motility disorder or some obstructive pathology. So she's a young lady, so we thought we could again do an endoscopy for her ourselves to see what is happening. So this was done under anesthesia because we wanted to be really slow, didn't want to miss any bands or narrowing or stricture that would open up during a regular scopy. So we did under anesthesia. Very minimal inflation and a little slow, not like regular conventional endoscopy. So we found a normal esophageal mucosa. Since we've already had a couple of endoscopies done, we critically found that she did have a posterior indentation at about 15 centimeters from the cricothorax. And she did have mild esophagitis and other findings as well. But none of those really corroborated to her symptom of vomiting and loss of weight for about 40 kilograms. So we planned to do a barium rinse. So this was the barium finding. Could I have some thoughts on this? It looks like a very smooth proximal esophagus. And there was some kind of constriction that we found at the just above the
posterior one third of the tongue is normal.
Yeah.
Then the cervical part, there is a dilatation of the after that there is a irregular contractions which is seen in the in this lower portion of the cervical portion of the esophagus, and a smooth flow is there in the distal one third of the thoracic part of the esophagus. In the AP view, both the piriform sinuses are normal. And the flow is seen. There is slight narrowing is there in the part of the esophagus is there.
Mr. Okay. So we just need some diagram. So we also thought this narrowing could be a little significant. So we went on to do. That was a vascular surgeon. I straight away asked for a CT angiogram. I had nothing in mind though. So if I play this. Actually, I found out in this CT angiogram was so there was a common origin of both the carotids from the vagus and the trunk, and the right vertebral was taken off straight from the arch, and there was an aberrant right supplementary. There was a bit of proximal dilatation at the origin, and it was coursing all the way posterior and inferior to the arch of the arch, and it was causing mild irritation across the esophagus. Thought this probably would be causing her symptoms of vomiting, loss of weight, with no other specific symptom than the GI pathology. So, taking a chance, I told her everything and took her up for surgery. So, what was a little difficult for me to explain was generally we find an aneurysmal dilatation across the esophagus. That could probably be causing this irritation. But the retrospective thought was probably because she's lost some weight, there could be some loss of peri-esophageal fat, and that probably could be causing this. The normal aberrant right supplement causing irritation and vomiting symptoms. So, having a common origin of the carotids in mind for the vagus and the leg, we thought we contemplated it could be a sternotomy or just a neck incision. Generally, a neck incision alone would be enough to tackle this entire issue. But since she had a very common origin, we didn't want to take chances. We went ahead with a sternotomy. So, a full length sternotomy was performed. We encircled the esophagus. So, the first picture on the left side was the exposure. So we for the first sling here, this sling is holding the brachiocephalic trunk vein. So this is the esophagus. So once we dissected this, and this is the course of the aberrant right subclavian artery coming from posterior to the arch, going behind the esophagus and then the right side upper lung. There was a lot of posterior esophageal fibrosis because of recurrent esophagitis there. So that it did require a bit of gut to put my finger between the vessel and the esophagus to clear out the bulk of the vessel. So once that was done, things were quite simple. We had to side clamp the ascending aorta, ascending two subclavian bypass was done. I was lucky in this side because the vertebral was taking a separate origin from the arch, so it made my work really easy. I had not rebound the vertebral artery. So the post-operative period was quite alright for us. She just had some minor lung infection because of the sternotomy. Otherwise, I put her on single antiplatelet and medications for esophagitis because endoscopy also had other findings. See, at discharge, her vomiting was still there, but then her dysphagia symptoms at least disappeared. She did not have to be on anxiolytics and other medication that had to put her away. So she's now on 2 months follow-up and on telephonic follow-up. She's from West Bengal. So she's put on some weight also. So she's eating fine and her activities are also all right. See, the alternate management plan that could have been there, the simpler ones as in the neck incision could have been made. To just like it, the vessel alone and come, because generally the right, the upper limb per se does not really require a pulsatile flow. It can really establish well over the course of time with just collaterals. The coil embolization of the aberrant subclavian followed by TVAD is the real option as of now. The patient is not fit for an open surgery, followed by a captain subclavian bypass. But all those finances have been an issue, so weren't really my thoughts on the first time. From these two, I mean, the conclusion from here is the swallowing is airway complex processing, so is the evaluation for dysphagia. So when there is non-respondence to primary therapy with for dysphagia, I think a second line imaging or a combined multimodality imaging will be required to evaluate dysphagia as a whole. It can involve endoscopy with barium, manometry, pH, sometimes CT as well. So I think combined modality is required when there is non-respondence to first line therapy. Thank you,
I request Dr. Thiruma, please come forward and hand over the certificate of appreciation to Professor Ellen and Dr. Jain.
Yes. My job was only for 1 minute.